Hi there, this is a short video showing you Unity's animation system and its sprite system working together so that you can animate some sprites in your game or whatever project you're building. So I've got an empty Unity project here. The only thing different about it is that I have imported a couple images. The first three images are three frames of animation of an existing video game character. The last image I have here is a sprite sheet that is simply one image that contains those three images put together. I'll show you how to work with either of these. First thing for us to do is to convert these into sprites. All I have to do is select the texture 2Ds here and then change their mode to sprite. I'm also going to change the packing tag. This is a technical thing. This is how Unity will batch these together into one image eventually for optimization reasons. You'll see I also picked point filtering here. Point filtering is the way pixels are blended when you resize an image. So if you're working with a pixel art game, you're probably going to want your resampling, your filtering to be set to point. But if you're working with hand-drawn images or photographs or something that you want smooth lines in that you don't want to be seeing pixels for, then you want to change over to bilinear or trilinear to actually get that resize filtering. If you have a sprite sheet to work with, just select that sprite sheet texture, make sure it's set to a sprite, and change its mode to multiple. Once it's set to multiple, you can click the sprite editor button, and then we'll be able to chop it up very, very quickly. Okay. So here's our image. If you click on the top left here, the automatic settings work quite well. You can just hit slice and it will break them up into three separate images that you can adjust and resize if you wish. Then just hit apply, it's on the top bar. So now we can expand this inside our project view and we can see the three separate frames just like the first three we have here. You can see when I place either of these into the scene view that they look the same, they're the same images. So as I mentioned earlier, it doesn't matter if you're working with a sprite sheet or individual frames. I'm going to delete the sprite sheet just to keep things simple here, just so you're not confused. So let's bring him into the scene by dragging him in and then open the animation window. The animation window is pretty simple. If you've used Animation Timeline in Flash or Maya or any other animation program before, a lot of it's going to be pretty self-explanatory. We have a timeline, we have play and record buttons. And if you select any object in your scene, we can click in this area here and create a new clip. So this creates an animation clip as a new file that we can play for this character. So now we can drag around in the timeline. We have something we're actually working with. And I can just drag and drop sprites into this timeline to animate between them. Since this is kind of old-fashioned sprite animation that I'm using here, I'm actually making my delay between sprites quite large. I'm not animating one frame for one frame. One image is actually lasting about 5 or 10 frames here. I can also drag them all in at once if you have a long PNG sequence and you want every frame to play, and it will automatically drag them in sequence. Of course, this is too fast for my use, so I'm just going to space them back out. I'm not going to be able to see anything in play mode right now, so I'm just going to move my camera to be a little bit closer to my subject. Okay, here we go. He's animated. Now that was the walk animation. I'm going to make a second animation, just called an idle animation, and nothing's actually going to move, but it's going to be recognized as an animation clip that we can play with. Just going to drag in one sprite. That's all we need out of this. It would be nice if we had a series of frames to make an idle animation out of, but in a pinch we can just hold this one pose. So now I'm going to show you the Animator component. Animator and animation are not to be confused. Think of Animator as the thing that marshals all the animation, whereas the animation itself is just working with individual clips. So the animator is a state machine. Any animations we have will appear inside this animator window, the orange animation being the default animation. So if I were to click play right now, that walk will be playing automatically. We also get to see a progress bar while it's playing to see how it's playing through the animation and how it's looping. So if I make that default and play, we can see that cycling through now. We can control this animation by adding parameters. So I'm going to add a Boolean parameter, very, very simple parameter first. I'm just going to call it walking. And that walking is going to be a true or false value since it's a Boolean. So now by right-clicking any of these nodes, I usually like to start from the any state. I'm going to right-click, make transition, and click that on to the walk animation. And if you look in the right here, you can see lots of blending stuff that you can play with yourself, but you can see this condition thing. That's what we're looking at right now. So I'm going to say when walking is true, it's going to play this animation. Create a transition to the idle animation as well. Set that for walking false. So when I click play, you can see it's doing idle. When I turn walking on, it plays walking. That's how we're controlling this animation back and forth. We have variables within the animator that we're adjusting to drive animation. So I'm just going to make a really short C# script to show you how we can drive this. If you've done any C# scripting, this shouldn't be too much for you. It's very simple. I don't need to start. I'm going to make a public animator reference to the animator of this game object so that we can apply changes to it. And I'm just going to do a simple if-else statement to get the button down. We'll use G button, G for go, I guess. So anim.setBool. SetBool is a command of the animator that we can use, and walking in quotes matches this parameter that I've made inside the animator. So I'm setting it to true or false depending on whether or not G is being pressed. Okay, so that script is finished compiling. I'm going to drag it onto our object. Remember, scripts don't do anything unless they're attached to an object in our scene. And I'm going to drag that object onto itself for the animator component. There you go, so now you can see as I'm pressing G, it's walking. As I'm letting go, it's going back to idle. So one more thing I'll show you. I'm going to create a new object. And I'm going to parent our object underneath of it. And what I'm going to show you is nested animations. So if you noticed, all the animations we did on this monster were on the monster object. I can create a new animation on the parent object of that monster. And if you notice, I can move it around, but it's not actually playing the animation on the monster itself. That's because we're not animating the monster, we're animating the group the monster is in. So now I can move him around throughout the scene, and this operates as its own animation. Not really sure what this animation is. He's just moving around screen. This is definitely not anything you'd ever use in a game. Okay, so I can exit out of that. I don't really need to set up the animator for this since it's only one animation. It's just going to default to that. So here we have him moving around while he's playing his animation independently inside that group. You could set up a controller to move this character around with keys on your gamepad or keyboard or touchscreen and make those controls affect the group the character is in and have the walk cycle be unaffected by that animation. That's part of the value of nesting animations like this. Whether the animation on top of the character is code-driven or animation-driven, we can keep putting objects inside objects with animation clips or scripts attached to them. That's enough to get you started. If you get stuck, if you have any more questions, I highly recommend checking out the Unity documentation on the animator components and the animation components and the animation timeline and all that stuff. This is enough to get you started and get you kind of getting into some trouble and actually building things. So go forth, animate, have fun.